Welcome to Speechless. We're glad to have you here live from the SCC studios in White Bear Lake. Also playing live in St. Paul over SPNN. And we would be playing in Woodbury, but guess what? The city council there decided you can't have public access TV. So you're people in Woodbury, you should be watching this because we have a former school board candidate and a current school board candidate coming on the show later to talk about what's going on in Woodbury in the school district, the levies, the bondings, and also some potential unethical behavior by the school district. I think that will be fascinating to learn what's taking place there. You need to know. And if you don't live in Woodbury, this applies to your school district, the things we're going to talk about. So that's why you want to pay attention to get that understanding of what takes place in school districts. But before we get into that, I just have a couple of updates to talk about. And the first one is, I've been here almost 8 years doing this show on a weekly basis. And of course, you know this show is about judicial accountability. And one of the judges that I talked about way from the beginning was a judge named Judge Alan F. Pendleton. And had listed a number of cases where he did some really rotten deals. He could have been a fair person, but he chose not to be. And covered up for a couple kids dying in Children's Social Services program. And the parents, good parents, distraught over what took place. But that cover-up's gone on for a long, long time. And the abusive nature of what took place was horrific. But you're going to have to go back to my old shows to see that, which you can see on youtube.com/speechlessmn. This is a live call-in show, and 651-747-3838. But if you don't want to call in, have comments or suggestions, go to the email there, speechlessmn@gmail.com. The Minnesota Supreme Court just took away Judge Alan Pendleton's seat. He's been removed from office. And the two reasons they said that he's removed is, one, he falsified an election document as to where he resided. He said he resided in the judicial district that he was seeking office for, but at the time he did not reside there, and which is a violation of the Minnesota Constitution. You must live in the district, the judicial district that you're going to serve. The second thing is that he didn't reside in the judicial district that he was serving. So once he moved out, he was living with his second wife, and he moved out because the second wife didn't live in the district and didn't tell anybody. Although I had numerous conversations with his first wife, with her telling me she didn't live at home, he didn't live at home anymore, and that Judge Pendleton had moved out of the district, and she had reported it years ago, but things are slow in the process. So he is removed from office. It's not a deleted seat. Now Governor Dayton can go appoint somebody else to that seat. The problem with this, which this is a good thing because the Constitution provides for that, state statutes provide for that, and the Board on Judicial Standard going in and arranging this, they have that lawful authority. But the real problem is that this should have been done by the Minnesota legislature. That's who the Constitution gives the authority to do, to discipline judges, is the legislature, and they punt on this. And it's something we're working on. So the problem is, now people will think that we do have a system that holds judges accountable, but rarely doesn't, and it needs to happen a lot more often. So the legislature has abdicated their responsibility and to the judiciary. So now we got the judges watching the judges. So it removes the checks and balances so that the legislature doesn't even have it on their radar Very few of them do, that's their responsibility. So anyway, good news in my mind that Judge Alan Pendleton is gone. An interesting order came out October 13th by the Minnesota Appellate Court. Judge Hallbrooks wrote the majority opinion. Also Judge, I'm going to butcher this name, Kutich, was on the winning side. It's 2-1 vote. Judge Ross dissented. But basically saying that if you get stopped for a DUI, there has to be the right circumstances in order for the police to draw blood from you. In other words, most often there needs to be a search warrant where that police officer would have to go before a judge and say, here's what I observed, can we get a warrant to draw blood? And I think that's the way it should be because it's a violation of the Fourth Amendment regarding search and seizures. But the order here, I think it's very educational. I think it's well written on both parts, the side that says you need a search warrant and the side that says you don't. But another thing I want to point out is this man had a public defender. And it seems to me, in my experience, that if he would have had a regular attorney, he probably would have lost. But this, I see the appellate court and the Supreme Court doing more to uphold public defenders' work than they do the regular attorneys. I don't know, it's just a pattern I'm seeing. So I saw that and I go, wow, that's something that's regular attorneys probably wouldn't win. That's just my opinion. But it's key. It's a protection of your liberties. And I bring that up because we've had Michelle McDonald on the show quite a bit, who's ran for the Minnesota Supreme Court, who was arrested for DUI, and she refused a blood test, and so she was charged, convicted of that, but found not guilty of actually being drunk. But she was defending it on constitutional grounds. One, she hadn't had a drink. The officer said she smelled of alcohol. In the back seat, I should say, not that she smelled, but alcohol in the back seat. And of course there was no smell, but he could say it. And he ended up arresting her, but she wasn't under arrest because he hadn't met the requirements for arrest. And so when they finally offered no breath test, when they finally put her in the jail, the holding place there in Rosemont, they said she needed to take the blood test, and she refused on constitutional grounds. So this supports her argument. That is coming up before the appellate courts also. So we'll see what happens there. All right. Maplewood. Going to do a couple clips here. Want to talk about the aspect that here at SCC, you people who have Comcast pay for this show. I mean, we don't get paid, but the lights, the staff that's here, but everybody that else volunteers that does the public access side. Maplewood has voted to remove themselves from the commission, the cable commission. And so as of January 1st, this show and all these public access shows, it will go dark. Maplewood has no facilities, they have no staff, they have no ability right now to produce a show or to have the show being shown to the Maplewood residents. So, and then a number of us spoke down at the city council meeting, so we're gonna run my speech that I had down there, and we'll make a little few comments on the other side. So let's watch this. If we could start over.
My primary concern here is the city of Maplewood's ability to run a business. The Maplewood Community Center is a enterprise fund. Therefore, it's supposed to break even or make money. It never has. And for all these years, no correction has taken place in order for it to break even. So I question your ability to run a TV studio. Seriously? I don't get it. You know? Okay. And to break even. January 1st, oh, and then there's the ambulance fund. You know, that's not doing well either. So we can go through a lot of programs that you have that are not making money, that are supposed to be, or breaking even, and it's not happening. And I don't think it's going to happen here either if you take over the franchise. January 1st is lights out. You know, you separate from the franchise. You got no programming unless between now and January 1st, you got all the equipment and all the setup for what it is you want to do. And you talk about a number of cities that have gone and independent or on their own. You know, a couple of them would be like St. Paul. See, I think there's a big population difference between St. Paul and Maplewood. Minneapolis is another one. And so joining together in associations for cost effectiveness and expansive services, a lot more programming, is a very positive thing. One of the cities that was mentioned was Shoreview. Guess what Shoreview did? You know, the only program they have running is the government side. So in order for them to make it work, they cut out the education side, the public side, the, you know, there's be four or five channels that are gone. And so if you want flexibility, the flexibility is for less programming. You're not set up to do it. You're not going to be able to do it in 4 months. The people of Maplewood will have a great disservice for them. And you're talking about the city, the importance of the city, and the city being able to get its directive. None of these people, very few people here in the city, working for the city, live in the city. And this would be a chance for the citizens to get their viewpoints out there.
Please state your name and address for the record.
You come to me here. We're not going to go into more detail on this, but if you watch Bob Zick's show last night, Diana Longry's show last night, they went into extensive detail as to what was taking place with the franchise agreement for the city of Maplewood. And really, the only reason they're moving out is because they don't like shows like mine and Bob Zick's and Diana Longry's that try to hold them accountable, that try to expose what they're doing. And the proletariat down there is doing what they can to resist things. Another thing happened at the city council meeting. They have visitors presentations where you can get up as a citizen and talk about anything relating to the city. So I tried to do that. And we're going to have to save what I was saying for a later show because we've got too much other information to go on. But I had mentioned the name of Police Chief Lucan, Fire Chief Lucan, because of a fatality and his suspension. And I was going to comment on how the mayor and the city council dealt with it, that issue, in the press and at the city council meeting. So I was talking about them. I was going to talk about them. And they shut me down. So we're going to show you right at when they're starting to shut me down and go from there. So let's play this next clip.
The employees of the city of Maplewood report to the city manager. And if you have anything that you would discuss with any regarding any of the city staff, you should call Melinda Coleman as the city manager.
Point of order, I am speaking to the council and the city manager here. I get to say what I want to say.
Not about staff.
Yeah, I get to say anything I want here regarding staff.
We're elected. You can say about us,
no.
But you can't say
about staff. Yeah, I can. I absolutely can. And this is about your dealing with a staff member. I'm sorry, I get to do that. You may not like it. I don't know what you're going to do.
The time's up.
My time was taken by an interruption, so I'd like to continue with the rest of my time.
Time's up, buddy.
No, you used my time. Yeah, I have 3 minutes of my time.
Well, then the mayor can just adjourn if that's what you want to do, but I mean, that's the deal.
They make their decisions. This is business of presentations, and you've interrupted my time.
Mayor, can you give him 15 seconds to finish up?
15 seconds.
Sounds good.
Where was the vote in the motion to adjourn?
It's a temporary recess, right?
Excuse me, I was signed up to speak.
We're there. That procedural motion or procedural to adjourn because there was not a word.
I thought you were about coordinated communications, more communications.
I think you talked to your attorney on the news
here. Mr. Berglund, this is what the city's called their constant goal of increasing city citizen engagement. You have to look at the constant goals of increasing citizen engagement, and this is what you do. Shame on you. Shame on you.
All right, there's more to that, and maybe next week we'll go more into that. But I had mentioned Chief Lukin's name. That did happen. But it was in the context of the city council. Well, the parliamentarian, who cannot speak unless is told to speak, did a point of order. So it didn't come from the city council members, and it must. Okay, so she, a non-city council member, interrupts me. Now, the practice is you get your 3 minutes, but Karen Guilfoyle doesn't get to interrupt me. Then the police chief chimes in saying, your time's up. Now, that's the job of the mayor and the city council to do that. And then I rightfully fought for my time. I get to do that, okay? And they get to deal with it, you know? And Bob Cardinal, appropriately said, just give them 15 seconds to finish up, okay, because they did interrupt me, all right? But the police chief then talks out of order and says, you can adjourn the meeting. Well, they then adjourn the meeting, but then he goes, this is a recess, right? You know, so he may have used the wrong word. He may have told them the wrong thing. So everything was done. So the other people didn't get to speak, and I was told, evidently they get to write my script and as to what I get to say. And so this is a big violation of the Constitution. Nothing I did there was wrong, and we'll get my attorneys on it. We'll see where it goes. But that's just part of the city council not knowing their own rules and regulations. And I was standing up there. The mayor could have talked to a city council member or talked about the 15 seconds. You know, I wasn't out of order, okay? So, and who knows whether I was out of order. They could have answered and told me, you know, if you don't sit down, we're going to adjourn the meeting. You know, they could have done that. They didn't do any of that, okay? So, anyway, that's what happened. More of that next week. Okay, the big topic tonight. What's going on in Woodbury in the schools there in School District 833? And tonight we have Andrea Mayer-Bruestle and Susan Richardson on the show, and they're gonna fill us in on what's happening. So you're running for school board.
I am.
Okay.
Yeah.
And Susan, you did in the past for Woodbury.
That's correct, in 2013, yes.
Okay. So one of the things that happens, you know, in being a school board member, you deal with the education part, the levies and the bonding and the whole process. But I guess, first of all, what got you to run for school board?
Honestly, it sort of started as a joke.
All right.
like
like we were, you know, we were talking about it and talking about the levy and all of that, and wouldn't it be funny because we've been working to keep the district accountable and try to increase the transparency for several years. Mm-hmm. And it was sort of like, oh, wouldn't it be funny if I went down there and threw my hat in the ring just to see the faces? And we were discussing it, and as it came up more and more, I said, you know what? Somebody's gonna make a change. Mm-hmm. And working on, with the, we're also part of an anti-levy, or anti-referendum committee that we've formed.
Okay.
And so it's sort of one of those things where it became, let's defeat this referendum and then let's have somebody there to be able to actually fix what's going on. Mm-hmm. You know, and so it kind of landed on me. My husband also said, you have to do this. And when he says something like that, when it comes to the amount of time that we spend on these things and he gets annoyed usually, I got to listen to that.
Well, was he always on your side for running?
He, this time, or with this, yes.
Yeah.
In the past, when we've been doing other things, he's not always about it, but this time he was like, you have to do it.
Well, yeah, you definitely need that type of support. So you're finding out what's going on in Woodbury, and it shocked you.
Well, yeah, and it's not just Woodbury. I mean, we cover, District 8 through 3 covers Cottage Grove, St. Paul Park, and Newport, as well as Woodbury. So,
oh, yeah, other cities that now don't get local cable access because the city council shut them down. So it's hard to communicate with the city what's going on. That, I mean, I see that as the goal. But anyway, that's beside the point here. Right. That's my own personal dig in there.
Oh, yeah.
So what is happening in Woodbury? What's going on?
Well, what they're doing this fall is they are, they have a referendum on the ballot, mm-hmm. and it's a operating levy increase. And or an operating levy, and then also two bond bills that are $142.5 million that they want for that, and an additional $525 per student operating levy that's on the ballot this fall. So we're trying to get the information out about the spending and the debt and what this will do to the local taxpayers' tax bills if it passes.
Yeah, so you got some slides you want to show, so.
I do.
Let's start going through that and let people know what's taking place there so they can actually see the numbers and.
Right, and there's a lot of numbers. They should get the duct tape out and wrap their heads because they might explode.
Okay.
Okay, so with this slide, what it's being shown is basically it's showing the local revenue that they currently receive, and that's primarily out of the property taxes. As you can see, it's $28 million a year that goes into the general fund. One of the things to note about this is the $13.51 per ADM, and that's average daily membership. That means that's how many, you know, per the, like there's 17,700 odd students in the district, so you times that, and that's how you get the $28 million. One of the things to note about the $13.51 that's happened is the state has given 424 of that to the district, and it's happened to a lot of different districts, where 424 of that now is non-voter approved.
Right.
And they say, well, it's okay because it was approved at one time. So it just, but they've taken that, and this year in particular, just a couple of weeks ago at the District 8 through 3 school board meeting, they voted to take that up to the maximum amount, so it will be an increase of 6% on that 424 that we didn't get to say whether or not we wanted.
Without a vote, so taxation without representation for a local community, but the state said they can do that.
Yep.
So, wow. Yep.
So that basically gives you the rundown on that. So the next slide shows, this is the summary of what District 833 is asking for with their bond and levy. Again, the $525 amount is a total of $10.3 million for the next 10 years each year. And then the two bond referendum questions is the $96 million for a new middle school in Cottage Grove, which will cost $72 million. And then they want to repurpose the existing Altman Middle School and give that to the Nevaeh Fronteras Spanish Immersion Elementary School, who's saying they're overcrowded in the school they're in, but you could just cap the program.
And that's not a charter school? That's
no, it's
part of the Woodbury
part
School?
Of the part of the district, yeah.
Okay.
It came in about 10 years ago on an $800,000 three-year bond, or a three-year grant to start the program.
So the grant was from the state?
I believe so, yeah.
Okay.
To start it, and then they just sort of took it over, and they keep growing it. It's gone, it goes from K to, well, they're going K to 12, but I believe they're only in the sophomore year now with the kids that started in it. And kids can only, this isn't ELL, this is English language learners.
Okay.
This is American kids whose parents are putting them in the school at kindergarten. It's the only time you can't immerse any time other than kindergarten.
Really?
Yep. And they learn to read in Spanish. They learn everything in Spanish until, what is it, second or third grade? And then they go to reading English. It's our...
Oh, they don't even learn to read English?
Not until like second or third grade.
Whoa.
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah.
That is... I don't get that.
It's actually really funny. It's our... It's ironic. It's our least diverse school that we have.
Well, that would make me wonder why how their reading scores are for English at those levels.
They have some of the lowest test scores in the district comparatively, you know, not with the Title I schools or anything like that, but mm-hmm. comparatively they're some of the lowest test scores in the district and the least diverse school that we have.
Okay.
I could go on and on about that school.
Well, you're not against having Spanish taught.
Oh, no, and actually, that's a good point. This winter, they went through, the school district decided they had to go through a bunch of budget cuts. And one of the things that they cut, was the language programs in all the elementary schools. And the really interesting part about that is that with the language programs, the reason why the elementary schools got the language programs in the first place, because they were choosing, the individual schools got to pick if they wanted Spanish or Chinese. And that actually got brought in after the Spanish immersion program started, because parents in the district said, hey, our kids need language programs. They're not kindergartners. We would like language in the elementary schools. It seems discriminatory if we don't have it.
Right.
So the school district said, okay, we'll bring it in and we'll have it at all the schools and the kids will get it three times a week or whatever it is, mm-hmm. and we'll have Spanish immersion. So this last round of budget cuts, they cut it. And I brought that up in a meeting, you know, that this had been brought in the first place because of Spanish immersion. Why are we keeping that and not keeping not keeping the language programs, because it was discriminatory before? Mm-hmm. They told us the reason why they weren't keeping it was because it was too hard to find qualified elementary language teachers willing to go into the elementary schools and teach language. But somehow we're able to fill a whole school with elementary Spanish immersion teachers.
So a little baiting going on, saying we're going to do it, and then in the dark of the night, pull it out.
They just did it.
Yeah.
So it was one of the many cuts that happened this year. The other part about this is on the right side, it shows this actually directly came off from, it's a scan of one of the pieces that the district is handing out at the various meetings they're putting on, showing the tax impacts of the three issues on the referendum, and they're not exactly, I mean, they're correct for the first couple of years, but they're not 100% true.
Okay, so they're just giving you a small snapshot and not showing the rest years,
right,
the impact. Okay.
Yep. So let's see if there's anything. No, I don't think there's anything else. Okay, so the next slide is just to show you that the information you're going to see comes from their own financial reports.
All right.
Okay, so this one, we're going to go into spending because... Okay. You know, they're asking for an operating levy. And by the way, here's the other thing with the operating levy. It's $525 this year, and then they want to come back in 2017 and ask for an additional $375, because their goal is to get an additional $900 total added on because that will get them to the state mandated levy tax.
Okay.
Or, you know, cap for that. And one of the things that they did was they did a survey earlier.
The
maximum they can levy, yeah. Okay. Yes. They did a survey earlier in the summer and asked if people, you know, would be willing to support the $900 increase. Wow. And the bond and everything else. And it came back that the people were supportive of the district and of the academics, mm-hmm. but we were a tax hostile community. Mm. And that they said, you know, we can't support this. So they decided to do it in steps instead. And one of the school board members so nicely said, well, that way the people can, you know, we'll pass this one this year. And then in 2 years, we'll pass the other one. That way the people can budget for it.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, it was very nice of her. But one of the reasons why they say they need the money is they say that funding hasn't kept up with inflation.
All right.
So what this slide shows.
And I just want to interrupt here. Yeah. When you're talking about levies, that's paying teacher salaries. That's what that's supposed to be for.
It's the
levies are for learning.
Yep.
Okay.
That's it's supposed to be, the teacher salaries, the supplies in the classroom, those kinds of things. That's what the,
not,
yeah, that's
not
what
the buildings. Okay.
No, not the buildings. Yeah. So on this graph, if you look at it, we used 2005 as the baseline for spending. And that's what this is, expenditures per student, actual versus inflation adjusted. So the blue bar is the expenses per student, the actual amount that they've spent. The gold bar is the CPI adjusted inflation, based on 2005 as your baseline, mm-hmm. and as you can see, the gold line is quite a bit lower down than the blue line, and so what it's showing actually is that $199 million was spent by the district above inflation.
Okay.
So I'm not sure that it's a funding problem as much as a spending problem.
All right, but they're trying to get information out that may not be quite accurate and saying we're not keeping up inflation when they actually are.
Right, and yeah. I don't have the graph here, but one of the things that you can note too anytime you look at the information is the funding by the state has never been cut.
Uh-huh.
It's sometimes less than they want,
okay.
but it consistently goes up as well.
It's gone up every
yeah.
year.
Yeah.
Yeah, okay. You know what? This is a good time. We got a phone call. So let's call her. Do you have a comment or question?
Yeah, Tim, I'm sorry I got late to the call here. I was watching the city council thing tonight.
Oh, okay.
I've always loved the comment, levy for learning.
Now, all right.
My question is this. When you go to buy a car, you're given a list of all the other equities on there as far as extras.
Uh-huh.
And how much they cost. Why is there never a price breakdown for levy for learning? Okay.
Okay.
Levy for learning is for children. So let's break it down, and we need X amount of money for this, for the children. Not raises, not for assistant,
all right.
assistant principals.
Right, right.
Not for new carpeting, not for new office wear. I want to break down and where the money's going. Thank you.
All right. Thank you very much, caller. So any comments on that?
It's a great point. One of the things that the district brings up also is, you know, well, we have 85, well, I've heard it three different numbers over the last couple of months here, so we'll go with the first one. 82% of our expenses are salaries and benefits.
Okay, right.
Okay, well then tell me exactly where the other 18% is going.
All right.
And how that's working out. And that's one of the things that we've been battling, trying to get is the actual budget. And
oh, really? They're not
we
giving
can't
you
get
the.
It.
No,
we can't get it.
Well, we're working on it.
They want to charge us quite a bit of money actually for it.
Yeah.
And they know that we are we're not rich people. We don't have unlimited funds.
But this is all digitized. This is just sending you.
Oh, no, they'll charge you for that.
They'll charge us for that also.
Well, yeah. But they already have it. That's the point. Right. So they can maybe charge you $5, $10 for the CD.
$200. But want $200 for the budget.
Well, but they already have it.
They've changed some of that with what I've been getting lately. Now it's it was for the current.
We're giving discounts.
And my point is they're playing a game with you now.
Well, correct. For the 15-16 budget that we just started to get it compiled, as they say, and to do everything, they told me in an email yesterday that it was going to cost me $187.
Okay, so they're doing a levy and saying they need this X amount of dollars, but they don't know what they need because they don't have a budget put together.
And as a school board member,
they can't
doesn't
give
she
it
have
to you.
The right? Doesn't she have the right to look at that as somebody who's running for school board?
Well, absolutely.
She should have the right to look at that. Otherwise, how is she going to make any decisions? How is she going to be informed on exactly what their needs are if she doesn't have that as a candidate?
Well, and so now I can hear them say, well, she doesn't know what she's talking about. She doesn't have the information, but we're not going to give it to you. But she does have information.
Correct.
And there's
we
enough
information
out there to see what's going on.
Correct.
Yeah. It's just, they just can push a button and email the file.
Oh, that's what you would think.
Well, email the file.
We have an excellent tech group in our school district.
Yeah.
I mean, we don't contract out with that. Those are our own people. I mean, we had a 3D printer before a lot of people even knew what they were.
Okay.
My point has been, you know what? You can make the budget easy to understand. You can set it up and put it on our website so we can actually flip through it and see where our money is going and where it is.
It should be there already.
Absolutely. And that's what we've been saying for years.
Wow. Yeah. Lack of transparency.
Oh, extremely.
Okay.
So really quickly, I'm just going to run through the next two here. They're really kind of fun. This one shows the spending again. From 2005 to the most recent year that we could have, which was 2014, as you can see, the spending's gone up by almost 60%, while our enrollment has only increased by 9.9%. And it's actually projected because, you know, the graph goes 2015, 16, and 17, it's projected to go down. These are numbers that we got from the Minnesota Department of Education, who get their numbers from District 833, all the school districts, they send them in, and then the Department of Ed puts it on. To explain the little drop there, I'll flip to the next slide. Oops, sorry, wrong thing. This shows the net option out enrollment. This one is a little bit confusing, but basically what you do is you take the number of
school-age children
that live in the district that actually go to district schools.
Okay.
Okay? And then you subtract from that the total number of school-age children that live in the district.
Okay.
And that's why on this one, as you can see on the left side of the graph, they're negative numbers because the district is losing students. And it actually showed that it is going to lose about 1,500 students for 2015 out of the district that live in the district but opt to go to private schools, charter schools, other schools, homeschool even.
Do they know where they're going?
I actually found a little list today when I was going through some of this that shows some of them.
Yeah.
Or shows the schools they're going into, and I was kind of surprised because I hadn't seen that before. Mm-hmm. But I found that on the Minnesota Department of Ed, not on District 833 stuff.
Huh.
And then the next one is, when you're bringing up the enrollment numbers, one of the other things that you know, when you're talking about bonds and they're saying they need the space, they need the money, they need all this stuff.
So bonds are for building.
Bonds are for building, and we need to build this new middle school, and we need to, you know, expand the high schools because we're growing. Well, as you can see, we're losing 1,500 students out of the district, but then also, this one, the highlighted center when it says enrollment options under non-residents, that's showing that we have a total average daily membership of non-district students, so outside the district students, of 570 students last year.
Coming into our district.
And when they come in, there's some funding that follows them, but the bonds don't. Like if their district had passed a bonding bill, that money would stay there. Mm-hmm. They'll come to our district, and people that live in our district are paying for.
Yeah, but the taxpayer is paying for all the students.
Right.
The people in Woodbury, the businesses, the homeowners, they're paying for all the students mm-hmm. of Woodbury.
Yep.
And so when people come in from out of the school district, the taxpayer ends up paying for them too.
Right.
Okay.
Yep.
On the levy side of it. For the building side.
On the building side.
So, okay.
Yeah. Well, and ultimately, I mean, think about it, it's all taxpayer money, no matter where it comes from, the state or the city you live in.
Yeah.
It's still taxpayer money.
Right.
They like to say, well, it's state funded. Well, yeah, we pay for that.
Yeah.
State doesn't make any money.
We got another phone call. So, caller, do you have a comment or question?
I just have a couple quick questions. Thanks for this program. This is great. Levy is on, for school districts is on, I think, everybody's ballot this year. One of the questions I have is the school district, I had a daughter that went to school at Bayport for several years, and then she was transferred over to Lakeland Elementary because the lines changed, you know. Anyway, but I want to know the levy for Washington County, what are the test scores? How do they reflect with the investment per student? Are there students, you know, really high up on the national average? How is that working for them? And the investment, do they have a lot of students that are on special ed where they're getting a lot of state funding that's helping kind of defray costs for some of the special ed students they have? If you could maybe answer that would be great. Thank you.
Okay.
I have information. It's on the test scores and actually what we're seeing is, I mean, District A through 3 as a whole generally scores very high. It's one of the higher, I mean, mm-hmm. as far as that goes. But in the special ed funding, I'm not exactly sure what the percentage is. We have for that.
The percentage of students in a special ed program, I right. do not have those numbers either.
So, but I do have them. I don't have them on a graph or on here.
Sure.
As far as the test scores go, one thing I do know is that our achievement gap, which, you know, the difference between white students and minority students, our district actually is quite a big achievement gap. One of the statistics that I've recently heard is at Park High School, which is in Cottage Grove, the Hispanic students there, only 27% are actually proficient in math. Mm-hmm. And that's something, I mean, they keep saying, well, we got to throw the money at it and we got to do this. And, you know, there's other things that we need to look at on how to lift those scores up.
Right, without taking anybody else down.
Exactly.
Right, okay.
So, and then, you know, when we're talking about the out-of-district and integration dollars and things like that, too, that's coming into play, that's where Susan has some information about that.
Okay. Are we ready for that?
So when you look at what goes on down at the legislature, what you want to realize is that we have government agencies that have formed nonprofits that lobby our government. And one of them is the Association of Metropolitan School Districts. The Association of Metropolitan School Districts drives legislation through our legislature because they use $300,000 worth of lobbying money every year.
That comes every from the
year.
Government?
It comes from Krauss Anderson and Johnson Controls.
Okay.
So if you look on their online, they are a C3. And they're a C3 that for some reason puts out Democrat flyers on their website when they're supposed to be nonpartisan.
Wait,
to maintain their C3 status, you are supposed to not be partisan, and they are putting Democrat flyers, DFL flyers,
on their website.
3C
website.
Exactly. And they use $300,000 worth of lobbying money. They drive legislation, and our superintendent is on their legislative committee. So he is helping to draft legislation.
Is your superintendent paid in that spot, or no?
They are not paid. The only person that I know of that is paid is probably their board of directors is paid.
Okay.
And, of course, their lobbyist is well paid.
Right.
Yes.
I've heard that... Krauss Anderson is actually benefiting from the bonding bill coming up.
Yes, and we'll
not doing construction.
right,
but doing right. something else. So bonding's for building.
Right.
Yeah.
But they're getting, they get a profit if this thing passes.
Correct. Around 2%. Yes, they will get.
How's that working? That's just bizarre to me.
Well, it's a contract, and I imagine that they were willing to sign this contract. They got a no-bid contract with our school district for construction.
They're the construction management.
How much money did they get? Or was that bid for?
There
was no bid. They just said, here's what we want.
They said that there was a number of things they said they were going to do, and they would do it for 1.75% of the total building costs, which
if it passes,
yeah, and they're helping with the referendum efforts and yeah.
So, in dollars, that comes out to be how much?
About $2 million.
Whoa.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, Maplewood, they just reprimanded an employee because he made a decision that was over $10,000 without getting bids.
I don't know, the board, they actually voted on this back in, I keep hitting the wrong button, I've got it on here. They voted on it back in November 20th of 2014,
mm-hmm.
agreed to a no-bid contract. There was two people who voted no, but mm-hmm. the other five voted for it, saying, you know, they've had such good work with Cross Anderson in the past that therefore we should be able to do this. And
well, yeah, I wonder how state law comes into play there, because I just find that really bizarre.
Yeah, we find it strange too.
So if anything, it goes against the community standards of having competition.
That's true, but the way that school districts are run are almost an entity unto themselves. They don't necessarily have to follow rules and regulations that other cities might follow,
right.
That type of thing, or counties might follow. They have their own set of
right.
rules because they have very well-paid lobbyists that are pushing this legislation through. So if we look at the 2016 Achievement Integration Program participating districts, you will notice that on this form, there are quite a few school districts, and I know that you, Tim, had specifically asked about Matamidi, so there's a red arrow indicating that Matamidi on this form is one of the participating districts. On page 2, you can see that South Washington County is one of the participating districts, and we're going to go through exactly why these districts want to participate in this. So we're going to look at the statutes. The enrollment options program, what this means is that a child, a minority student who wants to be enrolled in this program can give 24 hours notice, and they could be in our school district within 24 hours. So
wow.
An applicant can transfer, they can submit an application at any time, and the pupil may transfer to the resident district at any time. If they are a minority student. If not, there's our guidelines that you have to follow. You have to have it in your application in by January.
That's January.
And then that following year, you may be admitted if there's room. But here, you have absolutely, how does the school district plan when within 24 hours students can come into our district, whether there's really room for them or not? Now, there is a basis for their decisions. And the standards may not include any academic achievement. There's no academic achievement standards,
mm-hmm.
athletic or other extracurricular ability, disabling conditions, proficiency in English language, previous disciplinary proceedings. So if these students are violent, have violent behavior, that needs to be disregarded if they want to come in. And the student's district of residence is also not taken into consideration, other than they have to be within 50 miles of the resident of the district that they want to attend.
Wow, 24-hour notice.
Right. Mm-hmm. Now, we've noticed that in our school district, they've actually cut transportation and they've cut busing to some of our students, and we couldn't understand why transportation costs had gone up until we took a look at the statute subdivision 8 on transportation. The non-resident district shall provide transportation within mm-hmm. the district, and the resident district is not required to provide or pay for transportation between the pupil's residence and the border of the non-resident district. And then the parent can be reimbursed up to 15 cents a mile and 250 miles a week if they have to get their student to the border of that particular school district in order to be transported. So not only are we paying for their transportation costs, we're also reimbursing the parents.
Wow.
Yes.
That's just amazing.
Yes. Now, the payments to resident and non-resident districts, this is very interesting because for a fiscal year 2015 and later, special education aid paid to a resident district must be reduced by an amount equal to 90% of unreimbursed costs. So in other words, we as a state are paying for this student to be transported to another school district, then we're allowing their resident school district to maintain 10% of what it costs to educate them, those special education funds, and then we're paying their resident the non-resident district to educate them also. So it's kind of like a big redistribution of funds.
Oh, interesting. Yeah. So it sounds really like a hodgepodge, but a way, I mean, what is it in effect really doing? I mean, who's benefiting from this?
Well, they're claiming the students are benefiting from this because this is their answer to closing the achievement gap. But that isn't so, because what's happening is according to the policies, they can use this funding. They can use this funding for administrators, school counselors, policies and curricula and trained instructors, and they can use it to advocate and support and enhance the learning environment. But you can't use it for the buildings. So if you're bringing in 500 students and you don't have 500 seats available, then we, as South Washington County taxpayers, are going to end up having to pay for a building to house these students.
Wow, and then the law can change and you can be stuck with the building and not the students, and then don't have, you know, you still won't get the full amount of money with the student coming in.
Right.
But that could all go away, whatever you had.
It could if the statutes were to change, but the lobbyists, I am sure, for these integrated school districts are not going to allow that to happen. And the reason is because the eligible school districts, there's an incentive in revenue that is paid of $10 per adjusted per pupil unit, and then there's an initial achievement in integration revenue that's $350 times the district's adjusted pupil units. So they're going to get a lot of funding to increase their staff.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
So we're almost out of time. We only got about 3 minutes left here. But it's just busing and moving a lot of people around, and various cities and other school districts are paying the price for it. And the taxpayers paying the price heavily.
Absolutely.
And really not receiving any benefit.
No.
That I can see. So.
No, no benefit.
So, in a couple minutes, kind of wrap up everything you want to say.
Well, when it comes to the South Washington County, one of the things actually I want to tell people that if they have a bond in their referendum, that they really need to dig in and find the bond schedule, the repayment schedule.
Right, yeah.
Just because of what we're seeing with the District 833, one, basically what I'm just going to say is double check it, because the one we have.
We need to get this graph up here if we can get it.
The one that District 833 is using, it works like an interest-only home loan. Remember the housing crisis of 2008,
right.
People
yes.
lost their houses?
Right.
They basically have done the same thing in District 833. The first 3 years is interest-only, the interest-only payment. That's why I said at the very beginning that the numbers aren't exactly right. They're not wrong, they're just not exactly right, because they're not taking into account that for the first 3 years, or they're not telling people the first 3 years there's no principal being paid. Then with the first 12 years, the average principal payment is $1.5 million.
Yeah.
The last 10 years, it is $12 million. You're talking, it's going to triple.
Right, so they built in an increasing levy.
It's backloaded.
Our bonding program here.
Yep, the bond is backloaded.
This is unbelievable. I, I, I don't get it. If you don't get this, this is, in my opinion, malpractice and deceptiveness. Mm-hmm. To have no principal being paid down in the first 3 years, and then, man, 1 year in there, $5 million automatic increase.
Well, and then on top of it, their interest rate's at 4.35%, which is a point higher than the average for bonds. And even if you did a 3.75% for the same amount of money, you would actually save $41 million in interest alone.
Yeah, and I'm sure they're going to try to go for a lower rate, but that's kind of beside the point, because you got this automatic bonding increase coming into the program.
And they're not telling people about it. So if you have a bond coming up, find this information on from your school district and make sure that that's not happening to you too.
Yeah.
That's a big deal.
Okay, so people in the Woodbury Cottage Grove area, School District 833, you got some school board races, so your recommendation is just to vote no. Tell them to go back.
Vote no to all three.
There's three questions. Vote no for all three and vote for me.
And the school will be fine.
Well,
absolutely.
They'll be able to financially still make it.
Correct.
Yeah. They will. And they have a $250 million budget. I think they'll be fine.
This is excess.
Yeah.
This is clearly excess. What the state gives is enough.
Yeah. And then vote for Andrea Mayer.
I'm number two on the ballot.
Number two?
Yeah.
Okay. All right. Well, people, it's essential for your liberties. Hold the government accountable. Remember, if you don't stand up for other people's liberties, who's going to stand up for yours? And good men don't do nothing. God bless. Have a great week. We'll see you next week.